Franz Schubert. Whom Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau called the Prince of Song, left this earth when he was 31 years old. In his music, he gave most of himself to the songs for solo voice and piano, Lieder, as the form is known. Symphonies. The string quartets. Cantatas. Or the sonatas for piano. We find the probing restlessness of an indefatigable composer, one who left 11 such sonatas for pianoforte in various states of incompletion, including this one, once referred to as Reliquia, as it was thought to be some of the last music that he wrote, a relic of his own, as he would put it in a letter to his brother Ferdinand, indescribable power of the earth to create new life. I have a strange theory, which is very perverse, and it is not infallible, certainly, but it is that we're dealing with the skeleton of a sonata, a sketch that Schubert intended to revise further, as it seems to be lacking in the figuration and thematic gestures of the works he actually did complete. It makes it quite compelling to interpret the sparseness of these motives and progressions instead as something that is half finished, half formed, an idea in wait, merely a plane of potentialities. It is worth pointing out that the piano on which we are about to hear this rather lengthy and unusual work, a New York Steinway & Sons from the 1870s, belonging to the Philosophical Research Society in Los Angeles, would have left the factory a mere 40 or so years after Schubert's death, roughly equivalent to the time that I have been alive, its light and brilliant tone being well suited to conveying Schubert's musical imagination. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Schubert was a wanderer. He wrote that there is probably nothing more pleasant than to walk about outside in the evening after a hot summer's day. Perhaps we can deduce that from these activities he was able to offset the pains of existence, notwithstanding an occasional audacious outburst. As was once expressed in his diary, there are only a few moments which enlighten life's gloom. In the afterlife, the blissful moments will become everlasting joy, and more blissful ones will give us glimpses of more blissful worlds. Such is Schubert's profound connection to life's gloom and pain, as embodied in his slow movements, and such are the contrasts here between the major and minor modes in the Andante, a tempo indication which in itself proves suitable for a wanderer, as its literal meaning signifies at a walking pace.
Thank you.
This third movement, a minuet, exists as a fragment which was left incomplete, except for the trio section which occurs in the middle of it in G sharp minor, which Schubert did manage to complete. And here are where things get interesting, where we can locate a hybrid, an alternate universe in which Schubert completes his sonata. Various people have taken it upon themselves to fill in the gaps to these last two movements that Schubert left behind, but for today we will be focusing on the completion by the Austrian-born and later American émigré composer Ernst Krenek, which is perhaps the best known and the one that I happened to discover by chance via YouTube algorithm. Krenek, who spent the last years of his life not very far from here in the Colorado desert of California, once discussed Schubert's style, admitting that he had at first shared the widespread opinion that Schubert was a lucky inventor of pleasing tunes, lacking dramatic power and searching intelligence. Krenek's music fully embraced the 12-tone method of composition of the Second Viennese School. And so it is surprising to find in his completion of this sonata fragment not only a reversal on how he felt about Schubert, eventually saying that actually he was much more than an easygoing tunesmith who did not know and did not care about the craft of composition, but also we find a complete mimesis and commitment on the part of Krenek to the late classical style, taking each idea to its logical conclusion, and in a voice so convincingly not his own.
Thank you.
Try to imagine the ferocity, debauchery, and free-spirited nature of Berlin in the 1920s, the aftermath of the Great War, the time during which Krennic took up the task of completing Schubert's relic at the behest of his friend, the pianist Eduard Erdmann. Could one go back in time and find Krennic in a rowdy bar scene, a crowded room suffused with the lingering, wafting clouds of tobacco, expletives, all manner of impropriety, and a lost cultural innocence in the wake of political murders, hyperinflation, and global isolation? And despite this backdrop of instability, there's Krennic at the piano, over by the billiards table, making the carefulest of deliberations and decisions about how to proceed in the creation of a mutagenic composition, working out his ideas amidst the din. In his own words, he stated that completing the unfinished work of a great master is a very delicate task. In my opinion, it can honestly be undertaken only if the original fragment contains all of the main ideas of the unfinished work. Even then, the artist who goes about the ticklish task will feel slightly uneasy, knowing from their own experience as a composer that the creative mind does not always follow its own precedents.